Hello everyone. You might wonder why your mobile applications become sluggish as the device's temperature goes up. This thermal throttling reduces the device's temperature by sharply dropping its CPU and GPU voltages and frequencies if the device temperature is above the predefined threshold. This one-size-fits-all approach significantly hurts the user experience. In this talk, I will present GTT, a reinforcement learning-based dynamic voltage and frequency scaling approach that improves user experience and power efficiency while preventing thermal throttling. This is a joint work between KAIST, SNU, and the University of Colorado Boulder. Mobile devices are becoming more and more powerful thanks to mobile processors, such as mobile application processors and 5G chipsets. And packaging them in a compact space, mobile devices can perform high-performance tasks such as virtual reality, 3D mobile games, and deep learning applications. However, users still complain of inconvenience. They often say, "My smartphone sometimes turns off suddenly. The battery drains very quickly when using certain apps. Normally it works fine, but sometimes it lags. So what's the problem? Why cannot you fully utilize the powerful mobile processors?" The first obstacle is overheating. Look at the figure on the right. The graph shows the performance per watt. Apple A13 improved the peak performance by increasing the number of transistors compared to A12. Unlike laptop processors with sufficient TDP, they both have a TDP of only 6 watts. Considering they have 2 peak cores and 4 little cores, 6 watts is a very tight budget. In other words, the performance of mobile processors increases, but it is hard to fully utilize the processor capability due to the limit of TDP. The reason why the mobile device has a low TDP is that mobile devices do not have a substantial cooling method, such as a fan. Instead, they depend on the sink or heat pipe to dissipate the heat. This is why today's mobile devices suffer from thermal bottlenecks. The second obstacle is the inefficient power governing system. Power efficiency is very important for better operated mobile devices. However, there is a trade-off between power consumption and performance. Therefore, finding optimal balance between the two is crucial, but it is not easy. The dynamic voltage and frequency scaling, or DVFS in short, is designed to balance them to improve power efficiency. The power consumption of a processor is determined by its utilization and voltage frequency level. So you adjust the voltage frequency level dynamically based on the predefined processor utilization levels. As a result of reducing power consumption, it indirectly prevents overheating. However, DVFS has some limitations. First, the existing DVFS is application agnostic. Since it operates depending on the processor state at the OS level, it cannot accurately reflect the performance of the actual application. Second, each processor has its own governor. The governor means a DVFS module. Therefore, it is impossible to optimally distribute the input among them. In fact, thermal throttling is a well-known technique to prevent overheating. If the current cooling power is not enough and it overheats above a certain temperature, it significantly lowers the processor's clock frequency. Look at the figure on the right. It shows the frame rate of a video along with the CPU temperature. You can see the moment in two red circles where frame rates sharply drop. This is where thermal throttling happens to cool down the system by reducing the frame rates. Rapid performance degradation is a limitation of thermal throttling, so it is best to avoid it as much as possible. Tackling the inefficiency of these existing solutions, we set these research goals. First, we designed the DVFS to reflect the performance of the application. We control CPU and GPU together to maximize user QoE. We also aim to minimize power consumption. Our objective is to maximize the utility UT over all time slots while reducing power consumption PT with the trade-off parameter beta. Our utility function is user QoE that increases with higher frame rates, but it will not improve further after regional frames. Second, we aim to prevent thermal throttling. In order to do this, we predict thermal budget to prevent it from being prematurely exhausted. There are several challenges in our study. First, it is difficult to predict the temperature. because the temperature of mobile devices is sensitive to complex internal and external environments. For example, if your mobile device is currently in your pocket or charging, it will get hot quickly. On the other hand, if the device is in a cool environment, the device's temperature is highly likely low. Also, the type of location greatly affects the usage of each processor. Second, it is difficult to predict the performance of the application. This is because different users and applications have different resource requirements. To overcome these challenges, we propose DDT, a deep reinforcement learning-based hybrid frequency scaling system. DDT aims to predict the future temperature and application performance from previous samples. Look at this figure. The shaded area in the graph is the temperature buzzing. This is determined by various factors. For example, cool environments have a larger temperature buzzing. Then we have to find the optimal point by adjusting the CPU and GPU clock frequencies within this temperature buzzing. For example, for CPU-intensive tasks, it is optimal to set a relatively high CPU clock frequency. To do this, we design a novel reward function. GDT also aims to adapt quickly to changing summer environments. For evaluation, we experiment with the Google Pixel 3a smartphone and Jetson TX2 board in real environments. Let me explain our system design. Before using reinforcement learning, we modeled it as a Markov decision process. The state is defined as follows. Our states are defined by a tuple containing 7 parameters, CPU and GPU clock frequencies, temperatures, and power consumptions. Targeting video and gaming applications, we observe the frame rate at time t. Frame rate is an important performance metric for user experience. Action is defined by the clock frequency of CPU and GPU. Now, it is modeled as a decision process to control the clock frequency of the CPU and GPU by observing the current state. Next is our reward design. A reward is defined as the sum of 3 terms. Utility is a term for maximizing user QE. Users usually do not feel much difference in satisfaction when the frame rates go above a certain level. Based on this, we define U as in the figure. The orange line is the target frame rate. It can be flexibly set by the application provider or users. Therefore, utility increases steadily until the target frame rate is achieved and then becomes constant. Next is total power consumption. This is a term to minimize total power consumption. And the bera is a handle for balancing these two terms. W is a penalty to prevent the temperature from rising above the threshold. Look at this figure. The orange line is the threshold at which summer throttling occurs, and it can be set lower. When the temperature body is sufficient, a constant reward is given, but it is designed to give a larger penalty as it approaches the threshold temperature. Finally, the model is defined as the problem of selecting an action every time step to maximize the sum of the rewards for all times. However, we do not know the transition probability between each state and action. Model-free reinforcement learning is designed to solve these problems through sampling. In addition, to deal with large state action spaces, we use the deep reinforcement learning-based system. Based on the MDP model, we implement a deep learning-based DVFS. First, the GDT agent selects the clock frequency of CPU and GPU at time t. In this case, it takes an epsilon greedy behavior. For exploration, it takes uniform random actions with an epsilon probability. For exploitation, it takes the action of the highest Q function with a 1 minus epsilon probability. In conventional epsilon greedy, the exploration is done without considering its result. Therefore, an adverse reaction can cause some throttling in our case. To avoid such critical happenings, we let GDT randomly select one of the clock frequencies lower than the current clock frequency when approaching the threshold temperature. This approach prevents drastic performance degradation from summer throttling, thus keeping the application performance much more stable during adaptation. After taking an action, it observes the next state of the system. When the reward is given based on the observed state, the sample is stored as a tuple in the replay memory. When enough samples are collected, random sampling is performed from the replay memory and batch training is performed to update the queue network. By doing so, ZTT runs about environments and applications, and it gets the ability to predict some headroom. However, this does not sufficiently provide the adaptation ability to ZTT because the DQN is originally designed to serve MDP. To overcome this limit, we adapt two more techniques to implement the learning in ZTT that enables adaptation to changing environments or applications. When the environment changes, the mobile device's external characteristics also change. Samples collected for environmental changes should be emphasized in training and adaptation so that those changes can later be adapted more quickly. To do so, you append a set of additional copies of those unique samples to the replay memory to highlight them during the batch training. Left figure shows the frame rate when the environment changes from a warm indoor to a cool outdoor environment with our system. As the number of sample copies increases, adaptation gets faster. However, for three or more copies, we observe that overfitting causes excessive resource usage. As shown in the figure on the right, even with only one sample copy, the adaptation time reduces by half. We observe that using one or two sample copies makes ZTT sufficiently efficient in adapting to a new environment. Learning a new environment from zero knowledge is not only inefficient, but also degrades application QE. To make ZTT more efficient, we use the transfer learning technique. Figure shows the adaptation time improvement with transfer learning with additional knowledge, such as environment and application type. It shows that transfer learning reduces more than half compared to the baseline of random sampling, indicating that the learning time reduces significantly with additional knowledge. We implemented ZTT on Google Pixel 3a and Jetson TX2 board. We removed the fan of the TX2 to make it similar to the mobile device environment. We measured the power consumption of Pixel 3a by using a Bunsen power monitor. For comparison, we also used these governors in each device. Maestro is a recent DevFS mechanism that aims at guaranteeing QoS of mobile apps under some constraints. It proactively detects the QoS level of an application. Then it performs the proportional integral control-based DevFS to meet the QoS level. Other governors are provided by its processor manufacturer and OS, and we call these settings as default. First, we check the performance and power consumption of ZTT and the others with applications requiring different target FPSs on TX2. In the figure, ZTT guarantees the target frame rate for three applications and saves more power over Maestro and default governor. After that, we slightly change the experiment to know each governor's behavior when each application sets the target FPS very high on Pixel 3a. This experiment aims to see how each governor behaves when the objective is not achievable due to the platform limitation. The target FPS of three applications is set to 60 FPS, which is almost impossible to achieve on the Pixel 3a. Compared to the others, we can see that ZTT tries to meet the target frame rate as closely as possible to minimize QoS degradation while reducing the total power consumption as much as possible. To check if the ZTT is using the predictive summer headroom well, we evaluated the ZTT with the three applications in four different environmental settings on the Pixel 3a. The four environments are the normal environment, the portable fan, the pocket, and the protected case. We set the threshold spill temperature at 65 degrees. In figures, ZTT achieves higher FPS compared to Maestro within the CPU temperature threshold for all cases. It indicates that ZTT can more aggressively utilize summer budget than Maestro. It increases the CPU clock aggressively as long as the temperature is still within the threshold. Finally, we let the mobile device experience three environmental changes. While rendering a video, target FPS is set to 35 and the threshold temperature is set to 15. And the thermal headroom is insufficient due to environment changes. Overheating prevention through a cooldown action occurs around the threshold temperature. After running the samples obtained from overheating prevention, GTT predicts the thermal headroom in the new environments and creates a new policy with lower frequencies. On the other hand, in a situation where the thermal headroom becomes more generous, GTT tries to improve the application purely through exploration. Next, let's see how the frequency scaling policy of the CPU and GPU has changed when the thermal headroom is insufficient. In the figure, we see how GTT controls the frequency of CPU and GPU before and after running the thermal headroom. After running, GTT figures out that the current policy can cause overheating and thus lowers CPU clock frequency to stabilize the temperature below the threshold, resulting in the reduction in power consumption by 7.5% without causing any thermal throttling. Nowadays, the latest Android app developers support frame rate setting to give users choices about thermal concerns, graphics quality, or power savings in a heuristic manner. However, it still overutilizes the resources due to the application agnostic VFS. In general, users who experience overheating while playing games are advised to lower frame rate or graphics quality. Therefore, GTT can provide an optimized solution to app developers, which can be packaged into multiple Q networks when publishing apps even with thermal freedom.